I'm DJ Premier, and I present to you, So What's Up.
Okay, computer. Run it back.
So What's Up.
Okay, let's take you to a journey of one of the greatest groups to ever represent the hip-hop culture, from their look, their rhyme style, and making a lot of people in the industry of their era copy their style. I'm talking about the Diggity Doss, the Diggity Doss, the Diggity Doss Effects. Shout to the iconic EPMD, the iconic legends EPMD, one of the illest groups to ever produce themselves and do the illest rhyme trade-offs of a duo. Two separate squads, there was the Hit Squad and there's the Def Squad, but united, they brought in ill artists like Redman, they brought in ill artists like K-Solo, they brought in ill artists like Heath Murray, and of course, Doss Effects. Now, when their first album came out, it completely just was a frenzy of everybody bumping that album. It was almost like a Raekwon purple tape. You couldn't take it out the tape deck. As they elevated, the second album got a little friction, and I'll even say I was a little guilty of it because so many people were copying their style of rhyme with the Diggity style.
Figgity boom, I went from Gucci to Stussy to Figgity Flam, a group beat to Zha Zha to Yibbity Yabba Dabba, Hoochie Coochie.
Their straight up suicide album just had less Diggity in it, even though they were still really fresh with the pen, still one of the dopest artists in performing live and on wax and cassette and CD, no digital yet, digital now. Their third album was almost like a return to the Diggity style. I started out with them doing a remix called Caught in the Act, which was done previous before that album dropped. It wasn't on the album, it was actually a remix to the Caught in the Act original version from Straight Up Suicide. And from that point, we went on tour. EPMD put us on two different tours. In 1990, it was Gangstar, DJ Quick, Chubb Rock, Father MC, even a brand new budding Mary J. Blige was singing back up for Father MC, What I Do For You, and EPMD as a headliner. In 1993, they did the Business Never Personal tour, and on that tour, the only opening act outside of their squad was Gangstar. So we opened up for them. It was K-Solo as the opener, Redman, Gangstar, and EPMD headlining again. Once we came back from that tour, everybody went on hiatus, including Gangstar. Fast forward to 1995, which was a super era of a lot of good hip hop coming out from all of us and everybody that was in competition with us. Everybody was solid with their albums. Great year, 1995. During that time, I get a call from them that they're about to do a new album, which was called Hold It Down. They came by the house. I had a condo at the time that I just moved to in 93, but I was looking to move. And right before I started to pack up all my stuff to move to a new place I had just bought, they said, hey, can we just come to your house and work? I don't work out of the house. I like to go to the studio almost like a job so that I don't just lay around the house and just sit around playing with the TV and watching stuff. I have to get up, get dressed, go to work. And that's just been what works for me. So since that's the best way for me, I'd rather you not come to my career. Plus, I don't want everybody knowing where I live anyway. So, with that said, we were cool enough from the touring times that we had, so I said, you know what, come by the pad. They come by, we sit in this small little room where I had a whole bunch of records and whatnot. The sample is a very well-known sample that a lot of DJs and producers are familiar with, just in our upcoming being DJs and digging for breaks. So I didn't really want to do anything simple, but they were like, look, when we come back out, we really need a strong single that brings the vibe of us just going back to our style, the way we used to do it, but also kind of a noticeable, familiar beat. So I said, all right, let's cook this one up and see where it takes us. And they said, okay, we'll record it. And when we record it, we'll see if it's the vibe. We ended up doing a beat right before it that was called No Diggity. That was how we started the vibe. They were like, that one's a little slow and we still want to keep that. Let's go with this next one that we're going to mess with. And that next one turns out to be real hip hop. It's not every day that you could really just call a record real hip hop, because we always complain about what's real hip hop and what isn't. And I'm really into dope titles, and that one's just pretty much just, you know, basic plain Jane, but Doss Effects are multi-platinum heroes that can really do it however they want to do it. So with that said, it was like, you know what? Real Hip Hop is the title. I like to always base my scratches off of what the lyrics say or the title. And again, we say this every episode, the sounds you hear are contained on this disc right here, which is transferred into a machine called the Akai S950 sampler. And then we trigger the sounds on the Akai MPC 60 during this era, which was my weapon of choice. Got a lot of weapons, but that's the weapon then. We went to the studio, the classic D&D. Shout out to Eddie Sancho, my engineer. Shout out to Dave and Doug, the owners of the studio. And shout out to Louis Teneo and Dexter Thibault, my assistant engineers. They've been mentioned. I'm not gonna mention them all the time. But anyway, we went in there and I was just like, oh man, I hope they do it like they were doing on their first album. And as soon as they went in and said, to the hip, dip, top, you don't stop, Dos Effects with the Real Hip Hop, it was something about, I bet they're getting ready to go. And then when he said, on your marks, get set, can't forget to go. In case you didn't know, the flow is Fat Like Joe. And Joe was in the video, just for that little piece. Shout out to Fat Joe, shout out to TS. And then he said, yo, you niggity know that I'm back, man. And right when I heard that, we're like, they're back. Because we miss the diggity style. I don't care if 1,000 people did it. When they do it, it's beyond official because they're the originators of that. No one was doing it until they did it. Shout to Crazy Drazy and Scoob, or Books in Reverse. That's Scoob best spelled backwards. The illest thing about the overall outcome, you gotta insert it into the S950. And as we load it up and connect it to the MP, push that play button like this. When that record was released, every DJ was playing it. It was one of the joints of the summer. The whole Rough Riders thing that was going on with everybody riding bikes and doing the endos where the bike goes forward and riding, you know, the wheelies up and all that. That was a new thing with the Rough Riders, you know, as far as bringing that out to the hip hop culture and it being everywhere. But it was dope because it was a lot of that going on in the video for Dos Effects, which made it look so dope for that era of the summer. They were back in action, man, and it was a great album. A lot of people on there on production, me, P-Rock, KRS-One was on the album. It was just a good welcome back to just doing what they do. Even the back cover was dope. And everybody's camouflaged out and the army gear, which is a real big staple of hip-hop, especially on the East Coast. And there you have it. To have another single outside of Gangstar that I produced was always an honor. I got the first single on that, and before you know it, Real Hip Hop is now considered one of the classic jams that I even play at my gigs and pops off when you play it in the club. So for me to have club bangers, which is very rare because mine's more street oriented, this is one that was a club banger that popped off instantly. And I got to give thanks to Dos Effects and the whole EPMD, the Hit Squads and Def Squad families combined, Redman, K-Solo, and you know, Keith Murray and so forth. And definitely salute this thing right here. The floppy disk.